America is essentially a
Welcome to the first winter season program of Network X, your news and public affairs analysis show. We will be on every seven on Thursdays for the rest of the winter season here on Seattle Cable. And tonight we're going to talk about a core issue, which is the relationship of democracy to media and the role that cable systems play in that. And we're very fortunate to have with us as a guest Don Hedden, who has 25 years of experience in cable systems. He is the director of production here at Seattle Cable Access Network, and he's on the board of directors of the Regional Alliance for Community Media. Welcome to the program. And I think we should start by talking a little bit about the history, not of the technology so much, but the political history of the beginnings of cable systems and the franchising process, as we know, as it started in the 70s.
Right. A lot of people really do not understand how cable operates and the whole concept of franchise agreements. Initially, cable was just stringing a wire up to the top of a hill so that people who lived in hilly, mountainous regions were able to get the broadcast stations that they had been unable to receive. So the very first efforts with cable were pretty low-tech and pretty minimal, and it was really just about getting a better broadcast signal. A number of things came together out of the 60s and into the 70s. You had the whole free speech movement out of Berkeley, and then technology came along that essentially the camcorder started becoming available around the same time that the cable companies started building out the systems in the big cities. One of the things I always like to emphasize and make people understand, though, is that cable operates as a franchise in each governmental jurisdiction. So in King County, there's over 30 jurisdictions. There's over 30 cable agreements between different jurisdictions: Seattle, Bothell, Enumclaw, King County, unincorporated cities in King County, and Comcast Cable. Also in King County, there's Millennium Cable as an overbuilder, as a second alternative in a few very small areas. But most people who are watching this program tonight are seeing it on Comcast. But they're seeing a large number of different cable Comcasts, because there's Comcast Seattle, there's Comcast in each city in King County, and then in the unincorporated areas, there's the King County Comcast. They're not the same Comcast company. They're owned by the same mother company, and ultimately the money goes to the same place, but there's this franchise agreement, and essentially a different company exists in each one of these towns and cities.
Right. Now, in most media that we have in the United States, say a television station or a newspaper, there is not much media democracy.
Right.
In virtually every city, we have only one paper, maybe two papers, maybe those both papers are owned by the same people. And on television, the owners of the television system are controlling who gets on, who gets a chance to speak. And also, there have been many groups that analyze it that show that they have a pretty pro-corporate, pro-government bias to their thing. So in order to make democracy work, there really needs to be a much broader ability for people to communicate with the other, with each other. And cable being a very broad band, allowing hundreds of channels, whereas, you know, and before in a city may have had three, five, whatever, through the air channels, you're not going to have hundreds of channels. And in the normal course of things, the corporate policies would not have relaxed. But because of the franchising battles, which I've interrupted your telling us about, the companies were forced to promise certain things that gave the opportunity for media democracy. Could you sort of flesh that out and explain that?
In the early years, a lot of promises were made by the cable companies. They essentially would promise almost anything in order to get a franchise agreement. And that led to, in most cities, a very democratic approach to access, public access in particular. In most cities, you would end up with multiple channels, not just one channel like we have here. One channel is not that uncommon either. But a lot of cities had multiple channels, allowing a lot more people to have access to public access and to through the cable system. And also, there would be a lot more facilities, like we have this one facility here in North Seattle. And originally, when I started in Atlanta, Georgia, we had five facilities scattered around the city. And it was a regional, you could go to your southeast public access facility, or you could go to the northeast. And that was not unusual around the country. And the companies, the cable companies, were promising to build far more than that. I think there were supposed to have been 30 of those in Atlanta. They only went as far as five. And within a year of building that fifth one, they started cutting back, and they were back down to four, then three, and then one.
Right.
And so the promises were made early on, but there came a point basically during the Reagan administration when they started pulling back on their promises, and a lot of those promises were broken.
Right. So the dream of people that were interested in democracy and in media democracy in particular was to give many, many diverse people a voice and train people to really be able to speak to other people. And I know in the early days there were some amazing successes where they would have shows originating in old folks' homes, mm-hmm. where the knowledge that older people had that could barely get around could be transmitted. And television is such an iconic and gigantic thing in people's lives. I think one of the dreams was to have ordinary people doing lots and lots of TV production from these various sites around their own regions,
right.
Because that changes your whole relation. You stop to think, well, just because it comes across the television is not guaranteed truth. It's just people like us making it.
Right.
But that promise has not been fulfilled.
No, I would say not at all. There's been a lot of disappointments. There have been a lot of wins. I mean, there have been a lot of things that have happened, because there were those programs that did record people who are no longer with us. I know I did my share of programming with people who maybe died young, or are also people who died in old age. But you know, it's a piece of their memory and their history that's still around that would never have been done by King 5 or Como or any of the big corporate companies, because they are operating. Their worldview is a corporate worldview. And in access, public access, we do not have to take a corporate worldview. Each individual who's producing a program, it's their view, it's what they're wanting to do. One of the things I was referring to earlier that actually ties in to what you were saying is that change in technology, and when people started getting access to camcorders, that's really where the world really changed, and we're really moving more and more into, as the technology becomes more and more affordable, the prices are coming down, and hopefully we're getting better. I know we're getting better technology. The quality of what we can produce today on a home camera far exceeds what we could do in my original expensive public access facility using those expensive cameras. Technology has been working both in our favor, and the corporations controlling that technology have been, in my view, working to some degree against us.
Right. So the again, to emphasize, the purpose of this show is to alert people to the importance already and the potential importance of having a democratic media like
right.
cable represents. And so parenthetically, I want to say that we certainly invite all viewers to come down to bring tapes that they've made down here to scan and try to get it. You can get a slot to show what you have produced, get involved in making shows like this. I think that's a very important thing. But the focus of the show tonight is the fact that there are many pressures and forces that are going to try to take this opportunity of having public access.
Right.
out of television, and could you tell us what some of those biggest dangers are and what people need to do to protect that?
These franchise agreements that exist between the different governmental entities, like the City of Seattle or King County in particular right now, are fairly long-term agreements, but they do have ending dates. They have tended to run about 15 years. And we're coming up on the end of the franchise agreement, both in first in King County, which is unincorporated King County, the non-cities, and then secondly, we're in actually a year left for the City of Seattle to really negotiate their new contract, which would take effect in 2006. The cable companies want to get the best deal that they possibly can to give their whoever owns the
make
cable
as
companies
much money as
make
they
as
can.
Much as money as possible. So they're looking for every way possible to make money, and they're really looking at the smallest amounts of money as well as the largest amounts of money. One of the ways to do that is to, first and foremost, they would like to take this channel back if they could. That probably won't happen because at the federal level, the federal law states that the cities may have asked the cable companies, not demand, ask the cable companies for PEG access channels, which is public, educational, and government access. So first and foremost, people should understand that this channel is not a guarantee. There is no law that says that there has to be public access on the cable system. All the law says is that the City of Seattle may ask the cable company to have public educational and government access. And that's where the franchise agreement and the negotiations that take place that create these franchises are important. And it depends, we have this channel only because up until this point, the City of Seattle has had the backbone to put into the contract that this channel exists and that the operating funds exist to fund this channel. It was adopted by most of the other areas within, most of the other governmental areas within King County, but without the funding apparatus. So the only funding that is maintaining SCAN is coming from the City of Seattle. We're trying to get some money out from King County and get them to become a paying partner and one of our paying supporters. And it is coming because there is this franchise agreement that's coming to an end in King County. People should understand that there is on the table now at King County a proposal for an extension of the current franchise agreement as opposed to negotiating a new franchise agreement. Probably your best information, especially for a media democracy person, would come from an organization called Reclaim the Media, which you can find at reclaimthemedia.org. That will discuss the whole issue of what's happening with King County and their proposal to extend the current franchise. And the problem with this is that the cable company, in return for extending that for what they want is 5 years of, is the county to give up channels in return, that they will extend it and not go into negotiations for a new franchise agreement. But the county has to agree to give up public educational and government access channels that are so-called unused channels. In other words, the cable company still has control of them, but the county has the right to take them, to ask for them back to use for public educational and government access. SCAN as an organization would be hurt by this because one of those channels is a channel that SCAN needs to be able to get more people on public access. We fill this channel up, so we could easily fill up a second channel in a very short period of time too. The current lottery that was just held, there were over 30 people who didn't get a slot for a regular series, and we maintain a large amount also for people to come in and do the one-time onlys, the OTOs that you were talking about, where people can come here and very easily get a tape on our channel as a one-time only. We maintain a fairly large amount of time for that, because that's really necessary, that people be able to do that kind of program and not really commit to doing a weekly series like this. This is a lot of work, as you know, and a lot of time and a lot of dedication to produce weekly shows. And we, as the staff here, have nothing but the greatest admiration for what it takes to put on these shows and develop these shows. It's not easy to do this every week. So the crew and the producers and this, the on-camera talent of this show and all of these shows has my admiration, because I know what it takes. But not everyone has that amount of time, and they need to be able to have a space where they can do it one time.
So the way I look at it, there's a little accident, a little chink in the corporate domination of life, which is because cable, when you built a cable system, you had to run wires under the streets. That made it a local issue. It became a rights issue. Therefore, the city could demand the franchise, and the cable companies promised to give this little bits of media democracy within the system. But there, we've been discussing that that's under attack. And the first attack that's happening is that King County wants to take back some of that stuff that they promised. Also, there's some efforts, bigger efforts even, of the cable companies to try to break that whole concept of giving local control over their own systems. Could you tell us about that?
Right. At the national level, the cable companies, and Comcast, I believe, is the biggest of those cable companies, and is located in 40-something of the 50 states. And they have, in King County alone, they have to deal, just King County, Washington, they have 30-something franchise agreements that they have to negotiate as they expire. It would be far easier for them if they could go, say, just to the state of Washington and negotiate one franchise agreement with the state of Washington for the entire state. So they're working down in Olympia, and have been working down in Olympia, to make this happen. And they're working in other states to get the state to take over the control, essentially, of the cities and the counties' right-of-ways. That's the reason that these franchise agreements exist, is, as you said, the cable company is actually using the public's right-of-way, the right-of-way, the property owned by the public. And they've been forced to pay rent in essence. And part of that rent payment has been public educational and government access. They're trying to get a better deal on their rent. If they could, they would like to use this property free and not pay any rent for the usage of it. But one of the big pushes that is underway around the nation is to make this happen at the state level. But an even better deal for them would be for them to get the federal government to take it over, and they wouldn't even have to deal with the 50 states. They would only have to deal with the FCC. I'm afraid that under at least the current situation with the FCC, that media democracy would not be very well protected by the FCC.
You know, in this country too, it is so much assumed, and I think incorrectly assumed, that corporations are necessary to get these things done. Are there any municipal or cooperative cable systems left in the U.S. as far as you know?
Yes, there are, but that isn't necessarily a good thing. There's actually, I don't know if it's, you know, you have to think about the politics of what you're saying, but there's actually an example of that that's much closer to home. Tacoma, Washington is an example of this, where it's owned and operated by the
system.
Municipal, and they do not have any public access there. People in Tacoma are working to get public access. They, of course, have government access, and of course, have educational access, but they've been without public access there. But that is an example of a municipal property. So again, you have the whole, is that going to necessarily be better? It's not been so far in our present in Tacoma, but they may see the light down there and come around to having, because there's some people working very hard in Tacoma to bring public access to them.
What about cooperative systems? Because as you were speaking, some of the very original, many of the very original systems were cooperatives.
Right. I'm not aware of any being left at this point. There's been so much consolidation and so much, the centralization of the ownership of cable systems that, you know, the big problem for us at this stage is the scarcity of the number of cable companies. Comcast is the outcome of numerous consolidations that I'm not sure how many original companies are now under the Comcast banner, but it's far more than just AT&T and Comcast. Both AT&T and Comcast had bought many previous companies. So even at the corporate level, we've lost a huge amount of competition. There's virtually no competition left. And I believe, as to my knowledge, there are no co-ops.
Right. Another thing that worries me is that, especially in the current federal climate, that it's not only the issue of making more money, but the federal government has been using the words, not necessarily right out to the public, but if you look a little bit, they have a concept called total media control. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that the spinners of things at that level are not happy about public access, and that one of the pressures why the cable companies want to go with federal is, again, they can get rid of it, reclaim the whole system, and run it back exactly like a corporate without this accident of having public access.
Right. I would back up a little bit on what I just said a while ago. In this country, I'm not aware of any co-ops. Actually, I believe that there are some co-ops. As a member of the Alliance for Community Media, it is actually an international organization. Mm-hmm. And there are some co-ops in other countries. But I don't believe there's any left in this country. But yes, that's the whole thing. It seems like this country is now moving more and more in the way of what once would be considered a small tin-horn dictatorship approach to controlling the media.
You know, there's so many issues that we've just touched on, and we have only a few minutes left. I wonder if we should talk briefly, just explain to us some of the things how digital is again going to cause a revolution and obsolete everyone's television sets, and how that's going to change things.
Well, that's one of the things that I have to deal with here is the digital revolution and the changes in the technology and as things go digital. And a lot of people don't realize that the television sets that they're watching right now are going to become obsolete in 2 more years. That the federal government made the decision a number of years ago that we currently operate with something, and what you're currently seeing is something called the NTSC signal, the National Television Standardization Committee. And that was standardization. As part of that, it's a composite signal. And back at the time that we went from black and white to color, the government at that point decided that they would allow the old sets to continue to work. So you could see a color channel or color program on a black and white set. This go round going digital, they chose not to go that way. And they've gone with a system that totally obsoletes the televisions that you're working now. You'll be able to use it, but you'll have to buy another piece of equipment that probably will cost at least that much more to make it work.
Well, we should have a couple hours to do this. Let me summarize by quoting Heraclitus, the old pre-Socratic Greek philosopher. You can't put your foot in the same river twice. Things are changing and changing very fast. 2004 is going to be a very dangerous year. Many of the freedoms that we have are under attack. Our access to cable television, which is a very important one, is under attack. Other things are also directly under attack. So thank you very much for watching Network X. We will hope to see you next Thursday at 7 o'clock and get involved with some of these issues. It's fun, it's fulfilling, and it's important. And we will see you next week.
Is essentially a just enough to scare this wind back.